are, I'm going to be taking you to this journey of the choice component. That is, how am I going to choose my components and how am I going to design a cast partial denture in this UG masterclass? All of you have been reading through all the different components, seeing a couple of samples and reading up your books. But today I'm going to actually visually take through this journey of how am I going to be selecting, and if I am supposed to be giving a cast partial denture, how am I going to do it? We all understand that the choice of treatment planning is controversial. And how is what is going to be my best treatment is always edentulousness now. All of us have been giving these in our routine undergraduate program, which are transitional dentures, also called as your acrylic partial dentures. But my dear students, acrylic partial dentures are just transitional dentures because they're not planned. So this is a tune which we are going to play in our treatment. Little RPD, don't you cry. You will be a CD as time flies by. No, as good clinicians, we have to understand the knowledge of cast partial denture designing, which is a planned cast partial denture and a treatment which is more promising for our partially edentulous patients. We all are in the era of implantology, but not every case is going to be a candidate for implants. Hence, we must learn the science and art of cast partial dentures. Diagnosis and treatment planning is always important. Hence, whenever you write an answer, you always begin with the importance given to diagnosis and treatment planning and intraoral examination. Maxillomandibular relations, vertical dimension of occlusion, plane of occlusion are extremely important again and have to be mentioned and understood. Radiographic evaluation is imperative before we decide any form of diagnosis and treatment planning. So let me take you to the journey of bird's eye view of RPD. Now I'm going to be discussing each and every topic because through 1 year that we've learned cast partial dentures and in 1 hour, obviously we need to have a bird's eye view. Means what are the significant things that you must know, understand, write, and answer in your examinations, be it theory or be it a practical examination or viva voice. To begin with, Kennedy's classification in a partially edentulous case is extremely important. And you must know it with all the diagrams. You know, class 1 is bilateral edentulous place, class 2 is unilateral, class 3 is an edentulous space, unilateral with anterior and posterior abutment teeth. Class 4 is an anterior edentulous span crossing the midline, and there are class 5 and class 6 as well. So the mention of all the Kennedy's classification with appropriate diagrams is extremely important. We cannot forget Applegate's rules. They are the 8 rules, which are again very important to quickly go through them. Your classification must follow rather than precede extractions. If a third molar is missing and not to be replaced, it is not considered in the classification. Rule 3, if it is present and you want to use it, it is considered in the classification. If the second molar is missing and not to be considered, then you don't include it in the classification. Rule 5, the posterior most edentulous area always dictates the classification. Remember that. Then you have rule 6, which determines, so edentulous areas other than those are basically modification spaces. Rule 7, the extent of modification is not considered. And rule 8, there can never be any modification areas in class 4. Why so? Because we understand that rule number 5 is the posterior most edentulous area determines the classification. Hence, class 4 is independently a class 4. It cannot have a modification area. So all these rules have to be accompanied with your diagrams. And that is something that you must know with your Kennedy's classification. Now let's begin with surveyor. What are the parts of a surveyor and its uses? What are the different types of survey lines? What are the factors affecting path of placement and importance of tripoding? So whose responsibility is it? A survey and design? Obviously ours. We are the clinicians, we are the budding dentists, and we are going to plan and survey our casts. The steps of surveying will include surveying of the diagnostic cast and drawing a tentative design. You examine the occluded diagnostic cast. You survey and design your master cast after you make your final impressions. You do tripoding and then you mark your components. Now I'm going to be telling you a color code of what color codes are supposed to be specifically used when you're drawing your diagrams and specifically drawing your components. But let's first see what is surveying. So we all know that GPT-9 is the Bible for the definitions, and you have to follow GPT-9 definitions only. I'm not going to be reading out the definitions to you. That's something that you need to read, you need to memorize, but I'm just giving you a brief layout of how you must be reading, how you must be memorizing, and what kind of diagrams and what kind of knowledge that you must have in your framework of your mind to help you write your answers. So surveyor definition. And the most commonly used surveyors is a NACE surveyor and Jelenko's Wills surveyor. That's the diagram. Beautiful diagrams have to be drawn. Practice them. I'm going to be telling you your 10 commandments at the end of this presentation. But that's how a diagram should look like. You must have on the right-hand side all the different captions which your diagram is going to be showing you. So that's how a surveyor looks like. And that's what are the different types of a surveyor. Now, these are the individual tools of a surveyor. So you can see left is your analyzing rod. Then you have your carbon marker, your undercut gauges, and your wax knife. What is surveying? It is the analysis and comparison of the prominence of the intraoral contours associated with the fabrication of a dental prosthesis. So what do? You place the cast on the surveying table. And at the 0 degree tilt, that means you do not give a tilt to the surveying table. Then you're going to be putting your surveying tools and you're going to be seeing the parallelism between your abutment teeth. So as you can see here, these are your paralleling rods and that's going to be deciding your path of placement or your path of insertion for your denture. Next, you're going to be checking for the retentive undercuts. Now, can you see this triangular area here? Which is particularly when you see this triangular area, what you draw is your undercut area here, just below your paralleling tooth. That's your triangle and that's going to be showing what's your undercut that is present when you are applying your analyzing rod. You check for the soft tissue undercuts. You mark your survey line. So that's your height of contour because that's your maximum bulge. And as you can see, your carbon marker, you're marking your survey line. The area below the survey line is your undercut area. So that's how is a diagrammatic representation of what surveying is all about. Now, height of contour is a term that you must know. That was first coined by Kennedy and Devan was the one who gave the term supra bulge and infra bulge area. The above the height of contour is supra bulge. Below the height of contour is infrabulge, and that's how your direct retainer is going to be extremely important because these are your areas which are very, very important. So this is the diagram. It's like an egg under. That's your egg. So egg, you draw your survey line. Your egg is going to be representing your tooth. You have your height of contour and your suprabulge and infrabulge areas. So this is, again, a very important diagram that needs to be drawn when you're talking about surveying and survey lines. Prothero's cone theory, very important again. So it's a pair of cones which share a common base. That's your height of contour. And that's what is important. The Prothero's cone theory is something. If you want a cutting edge in your answers, you need to mention these terms. Very, very important. Now, these are the type of different survey lines. You can have a high survey line, medium survey line, low survey line, along with the diagrams to be drawn. And you can have a diagonal survey line. So again, different types of survey line as per your surveyor and your path of placement. That's the undercut gauge, as I showed you already, the triangular area where you can see that's your the, to measure the kind of undercut or the depth of undercut that you particularly have on your cast. Now, look at this on the lower left side. These are your color codes which are given, and what you can see what is marked on the cast are your rests. All your rests have to be always marked in red. So when you're drawing your diagram also, red is the color code for the rests. The brown pencil has to be used for the metallic portion of all the components. The blue portion is for the acrylic portion, that's your denture base and your teeth. And your black pencil is for all your survey lines. So that's the color code that Stuart gives, and that's what you need to follow when you draw your diagrams. So now, as you can see here, all these rests are drawn in red, and that is particularly what your rest sheet. It can be an auxiliary rest or it can be a part of your direct retainer, but they have to be marked and outlined in red. So that's what you do when you survey and you design your direct retainer and your rests. Now, as I said, surveying is very important to determine your path of placement. And these are your four factors. That's your guide plane, your undercuts on the teeth and soft tissues, your aesthetics, and your interferences, which are going to affect your path of placement. Again, very important four factors. And you must know about these four factors, more detailing about them. Please read and draw with diagrams. Next, tripoding. I know understanding tripoding at the undergraduate level is a little difficult, but I said that when you put your cast on your table, it has to be a 0 degree tilt. That means there is no tilt anteroposterior or lateral or any form of lateral tilts. So when you do give a tilt in order to alter your path of placement, then you want to reorient your cast back to the same tilt. That's where tripoding comes. That means tripoding helps you to reorient your cast to your appropriate tilt that you have selected, which can never be more than 10 degrees. So you mark specific points which are either on the tissue portion of the cast, which are not going to be a part of your design, or in the outer surface, that is the index portion of your cast, you're going to be marking points so that those points can be scribed onto. And the same kind of points have to be touched upon by your paralleling tool when you reorient your cast. So 3 points to be marked in the same horizontal plane, and those are going to be helping you to reposition your cast on your dental surveyor. And that's what is the basic need and reason why tripoding is done. Now let's begin with all our different components of RPD. To quickly go through them, you all know, it's direct retainers. Rests are a part of direct retainers, but rests can be a part of indirect retainers as well. Major connectors, minor connectors, denture bases and teeth, and there can be stress breakers as well, which I'm going to be talking about later. We begin with the first one. That is, if we have so many components, and this is a bag of components, our quandary is, how am I going to select? You can't use everything for every single case. And you can't probably just randomly pick. It is the science behind picking your components when you look at a partially edentulous case and when you want to actually design, because you are the designer of your cast partial denture and you are the clinician behind the science. So I'm going to teach you how you're going to choose from your bag of components to design your cast partial denture. We begin with direct retainers. So GPD-9 definition again, very important. It prevents dislodgement consisting of a clasp assembly and a precision attachment. And it's very, very important component of a RPD. Classification, they are intracoronal, extracoronal. Intracoronal are precision attachments. Extracoronal are occlusally approaching clasp and gingivally approaching clasps. Now, how do the occlusal and gingivally approaching clasps look like? Occlusally approaching from the top. It's a push type of retention. They're less aesthetic, lot of metal. And what are gingivally approaching clasps? The ones which come from the soft tissue below, underneath. Pull type of retention, more aesthetic, can be used particularly when your abutment teeth in the anterior region, a canine, a premolar, first premolar. Then you can use a gingivally approaching clasp. Also, they are known as bar or roche, and occlusally approaching are called as acres. So all these synonyms are again very important for you to know, because any of the synonyms can be asked to you and you must be knowing that what means the same. what are the ideal requirements, be it a occlusal or be it a gingivally approaching class. You must know what are the ideal requirements of a class design: retention, stability, support, reciprocation, encirclement. That means at least you have to have a 180 degree encirclement, and passivity. That means your class cannot be active all the times. Otherwise, it's going to act like a passive extraction of your tooth. You don't want your tooth to be constantly, you know, like strangled by your class. So that's what it means. So these are, again, very, very important. A must mention when you're talking about a requirement of a class design. Now, let's look at the pictures and let's understand how each of these classes look like. Occlusally approaching class. As I said, from the top, they are the first very simple one is a simple circlet or your acres class. On your left, you can see is your embrasure class. Then you have your ring class down. And on your right, again, is your back action class. The less commonly used are the multiple circlet, the on-day class, the hairpin class, the half and half, and the reverse circlet. Now, all of you must know these names, must know these diagrams, because you can have, you must know the knowledge of the classification of your direct retainers and how they look like. Your gingivally approaching class. They are the I class, Y class, T class, and the modified T. As per the alphabet, they have been, for simplicity, named, and that's how they have been designed as well, as very clearly you can see on your pictures. Combination class and aesthetic class are also the type of class. Combination is when your retentive arm is particularly, so this is your retentive arm. So when your retentive arm is particularly made of a wrought wire, which is more flexible, more particularly used in your distal extension cases, that's why it's called as a combination class. And that's your aesthetic class, wherein you can see that this looks purely, it's blending with the tooth. And when you want to particularly use it in a canine, then you can use these kind of aesthetic class. They are the acetal resin class or the thermoplastic resins, which are used as materials for aesthetic class. The RPI, very, very favorite. RPI concept, RPI class. Where do we use RPI class? Why do we use RPI class? It's an extremely, extremely favorite topic that each examiner would want you to know. What are the three possible moments? Now, before we begin and understand what is RPI, we all know that Kennedy's class 1 and class 2 are distal extension. What is distal extension? That means there is no terminal abutment tooth, and there is both your edentulous spans are distally located. Hence, because you have a difference in the resiliency, there's going to be moments. What are those three type of moments? The first moment is the one which is happening around the terminal abutment tooth. That means the entire denture rocks like this. This is your fulcrum line and it's rocking like this. Then you have another which is along the edentulous span and your denture is moving like this. And you have yet another wherein you're in the center, the axis passes and your denture is rotating like this. So these are the three type of moments which you very typically see in Kennedy's class 1 and class 2, which are your distal extension cases. Now, what does an RPI do? RPI, which was first given by Kroll in 1973 and modified in Kroll-Tocqueville. Again, Kroll and Kroll-Tocqueville. You must know these names. Whenever you write an RPI, you must know R stands for rest, which is mesial, because particularly rests in any form of other direct retainers are always distal. P is proximal plate and I is R bar. That's why the I bar. So that's why it's called as RPI, given by Kroll, modified by Kroll-Tocqueville. Very important, you must know these names. So what does an RPI do? The RPI, as you can see in this diagram, the rest is moved from the distal to the mesial here. So if the rest is here in an RPI very typically, then it prevents the heel raising moment. Very typically the heel raising moment, which happens around the fulcrum line. That means it's lifting the denture base away from the tissue. So the heel raising moment is prevented by your RPI because of the shift of the mesial, shift of the rest from the distal to the mesial portion. There are modifications of RPI which can be also used, particularly when you have a soft tissue undercut. So the I bar is replaced by the Akers arm in case you have a soft tissue, though the rest remains always on the mesial side, and the proximal palate is something which is going to be touching along the guide plane of the tooth. So you have the typical ideal RPI and you have a modification of RPI, which is an RPA. You must know about the movements of the distal extension partial denture. You must mention about the heel raising moment, as I spoke to you about here, that this is what it basically does, that prevents the heel raising moment. And this is how a typical RPI looks like. As I showed you, a mesial rest. This is your eye bar, which is coming from here. And this is your proximal plate. A three-point contact, which is maintained, a 180-degree circle encirclement. And the basic aim of an RPI is to prevent the heel raising moment of a distal extension partial denture. Now we go to the indirect retainers. Again, the understanding of the moments is again very important. And what does an indirect retainer do? As I already told you, the first type of moment I explained to you was passing along the principal occlusal rest of the abutment teeth. This is the fulcrum line, as you can see on both the sides. So if there's going to be a moment from here to here, here to here, then this kind of moment or rotation of the distal extension base has to be prevented by something which is at right angles to the fulcrum line. And that right angle placement of your indirect retainer is what is going to prevent this movement of the partial denture. So the sinking in of the denture base and this kind of moment of heel raising moment is going to be prevented by your indirect retainer. And it functions with a class 2 lever. That means it transfers the class 1 to the class 2 lever. And this class 2 lever is going to prevent the movement of your partial denture. So indirect retainer, again, very, very important. It assists the direct retainer in preventing displacement of your distal extension denture bases. And remember, indirect retainers are only used in class 1 and class 2 distal extension cases. That is the choice of components specifically used only in Kennedy's class 1 and class 2 situations. What are the different types of indirect retainers? Auxiliary occlusal rest, as you can see here. Here, this is your occlusal rest, auxiliary occlusal rest. The lingoplate itself sometimes is acting completely as a indirect retainer. This is the canine extension you can see here. See, this is the rest and this is the canine extension. Then the canine rest can act as an indirect retainer. The whole lingoplate, as I said, acts as an indirect retainer because you have cingulum rests on all the anterior teeth. And the complete palatal plate, that means the lingoplate and the complete palatal plate, which are actually major connectors, but they also will function as indirect retainers. So these are your different types of indirect retainers, which are acting to prevent the movement of the distal extension partial denture, an extremely important choice of component when you're designing a Kennedy's class 1 and class 2 situation. Rest and rest seats, and what are the ideal requisites of a rest seat preparation? Now, rest is a part of a direct retainer. Rest can be indirect retainers, so they can be either ways they can function. What are the functions of the rest? Support, force transfer, indirect retention, prevent food impaction, stability, prevent tooth migration, and positional maintenance. These are the GPT-9 definitions of a rest and a rest seat. Rest is a rigid extension of a removable partial denture that contacts the occlusal, cingulum, incisal, lingual surfaces, and it's commonly prepared to receive it. That means the rest seat is, it's like the rest seat is what is receiving the rest within it. So what are the three different types of rest? Occlusal rest, as you can see here, typically cingulum rest and incisal rest. And what are the ideal requisites of a rest seat preparation? You obviously need to prepare the tooth. Otherwise, you can't have your rest fitting onto your external surface of the tooth. So you have to make a rest seat. So 1/3 to half of the mesiodistal diameter of the abutment is prepared. Then you have to prepare it spoon shaped. See, very, very typically, you can see this diagram here. that this is a spoon-shaped recipe. It has to be deep in the center of the tooth. It has to be less than 90 degrees at the marginal ridge area, and it should not interfere with occlusion. Very, very important. So ideal requisites of rest seat preparation, a must read again, and the different types of rest with the diagrams is something you must read. Now let's go on to the different types of major connectors with diagrams. See, diagram is something which is like the eye of everything. So let's look at the diagrams now, and let's look at the classification of maxillary and mandibular major connectors. Definition again, you know, it's the biggest component of your removable partial denture, which joins the one side of the arch to the other side of the arch. Ideal requirements, it has to be rigid. Very, very important. A major connector has to be rigid, because if it's flexible, it absolutely destroys your main aim of a cast partial denture. Vertical support, a means of indirect retention, as I explained to you, that it can also function as an indirect retainer. Opportunity for positioning the denture base when needed. It should be self-cleansing and not allow any food accumulation. So these are, again, the ideal requirements, a must important mention. Now look at the diagrams. Let's begin with a simple one, the maxillary major connector, single posterior palatal bar. On your left, you can see the clinical diagram of actually the framework. On your right is your schematic diagram. So the first one is a single posterior palatal bar. The second one is your palatal strap, which is more broader. Then you have an anteroposterior palatal bar, a very, very favorite kind of a major connector, which is very, very commonly used. Anteroposterior palatal bar, very rigid, very beautiful, less metal coverage. That's something that you must know. Then we go to the next. That is a horseshoe or a U-shaped connector. Very less used now because it's flexible and we don't want flexibility, we want rigidity. Then you again have a modification of an anteroposterior palatal bar, which looks like a closed horseshoe, or it's also called as an anteroposterior palatal strap. And finally, the complete palatal plate. So these are our different kinds of major connectors. Now, primarily, as I said, the complete palatal plate is used for class 1 and class 2 edentulous spans, wherein you have a very, very long edentulous span, Kennedy's class 1 and class 2 situations. In class 4, we use a closed horseshoe because a closed horseshoe is something with an anterior edentulous span that can be replaced. Otherwise, the favorite connector is anteroposterior palatal bar for class 3 situations. For mandibular, we have the lingual bar, the lingual plate. Then the third one below is the double lingual bar, which is a lingual bar with a continuous bar retainer. So these are the three different types of lingual or mandibular major connectors. The sublingual bar and the labial bar are less frequently used because they are very clinical scenario specific, and they are very difficult to maintain hygiene. So more particularly, you must know lingual bar, lingual plate, and double lingual bar used in periodontally compromised situations. Lingual plate used in class 1 and class 2 situations. Again, lingual plate acts as an indirect retainer. And when the sulcus extension is deep enough, you can use a lingual bar. This is the consolidated chart. I'm not going to be reading out. You can click a screenshot of what are the advantages, disadvantages, indications, contraindications of each and every major connector. So starting from your palatal bar, which is least commonly used, your anteroposterior palatal bar, which is very favorite. Then we have your anteroposterior palatal strap, your horseshoe, your closed horseshoe, and your complete palatal plate. So a consolidated chart, good to memorize, must know. For mandibular, again, the lingual bar, the lingual plate, the double lingual bar. Again, indications, contraindications, where do we use it and how do we use it? That's your labeled bar and your sublingual bar. Very less used, only in case when you have severe lingual inclinations, you can use a labial bar, but generally, as I said, not very commonly used. Next, we go to minor connectors. So we've gone through these major components and all those direct retainers, indirect retainers, major connectors, but we want something that connects them together to function as a unit. And that's the function of a humble minor connector. So what is the function? It's the connecting link, and it joins the major connector with other component parts. It transfers and distributes the functional stresses, and it transports the effect of retainers, rest, and stabilizing components. So please do not forget our humble minor connector. It's a very, very important component because it connects all the components together. How does it look like? That's how it is. It joins the clasp assembly to the major connector. As you can see here, this is the major connector. That's the clasp assembly. And that's your small minor connector, which is joining the major connector to the minor connector. Next, we have it joining to the auxiliary rests. Then the denture base to the major connector. So remember that your denture base also is a minor connector because it's not a part of your major connector. But this, what you can see, the ladder, the meshwork and all these are your minor connectors which are going to be covering your edentulous span and over which your denture base and your acrylic teeth are going to come. So that's a part of your minor connector. This is how they look like. See, the ladder, the lattice, the beaded, the nail head, these meshworks, these are all different types of minor connectors which are covering your denture base area to the major connector. It also sometimes acts as an approach arm for vertical projection. So now obviously this is your eye bar, but this eye bar, this is your approach arm. So that's also part of your minor connector. And this is your eye bar. Next, we've kind of finished with most of the components, except for stress directors, which I'm going to talk about later. But it's very important for us to know that in Kennedy's class 1 and class 2 situations, we must know what are functional impressions and what is the altered cast technique. Because a regular anatomic impression may suffice in a class 3 or class 4 situation. But when it's a class 1 and class 2 situation, a functional impression is a must. So when we divide impressions into two categories, anatomic impressions and functional impressions, when you're recording the impressions under a functional occlusal load, then that's what is known as a functional impression. Anatomic impressions, you know, you can make an alginate impression, you can make an elastomeric impression, you evaluate the impression and you pour a master cast. That's typically an anatomic impression. But what's a functional impression? There are various techniques. You divide them into functional impression techniques and selective pressure. MacLean's, Hindle's, functional relining method and fluid wax fall under the functional impression techniques. And then you have a selective pressure, which is according to the choice of functional impression materials that you are using. So that's your broad classification. This is the diagrammatic representation of MacLean's technique, wherein MacLean was the one who made wax occlusal rims. He applied pressure on the wax occlusal rims and he made an impression and then he picked it up in an alginate impression. However, Hindle's felt that if you're going to just pick it up with an alginate impression, then how are we going to maintain that load that we are applying? So what did he do? He modified. He modified the tray and made holes in the tray. So when he made holes in the tray, it was very easy for applying pressure throughout the pickup impression as well. So that's the Hindle's modification of MacLean's technique. Draw your diagrams because your diagrams are the ones which will give clarity of your understanding. And that's why I'm explaining you as well with the help of diagrams. Functional relining. Now, what do we do in functional relining? There's no tray or anything. You have to have your entire framework. Over your framework, you outline. Then as you see on your right, you adapt a spacer here. You make a tray then after the spacer. Then you do the border molding. And then finally, you do your functional impression with the type of mouth temperature waxes or with selective pressure. As I told you, you use zinc oxide eugenol impression paste, non-eugenol paste or light body elastomers. So when you're using the entire framework, then it's either a functional relining technique or your selective pressure impression technique, depending on the type of materials you're using. What are mouth temperature waxes? Mouth temperature waxes are the ones which remain fluid in the mouth temperature, and moment they are removed out of the mouth, they harden. So these are called as functional waxes. They are very, very commonly used in functional relining techniques or selective pressure impression techniques for functional impressions. This is the altered cast technique. Again, very, very important. The diagram says it all. So as you can see that this on the left is your framework, which is fitted on the master cast. That is diagram number one. I'm going to be tick marking. Then this is how you delineate that this is what I don't want now because this is my anatomic portion of my cast. So this I'm going to remove. So this is how my cast looks like now. That this is a cast that I've modified and I've made retention grooves over which now I have secured my framework. I've made my tray. I've made my impression now. And finally, I've poured my impression again. So remember, altered cast technique is a lab procedure of making your combination of anatomic and functional cast. It's not an impression technique. Your impression techniques are all those which I discussed previously, but your modification of your cast is your altered cast technique. Again, very, 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 very important. Must read, must draw diagrams. Now, functional impressions are over. We have knowledge of all the components. Now we need to design. What is the philosophy of design? Now let's quickly go through the entire algorithm. Algorithm means stepwise procedure or sequence. You do the diagnosis and surveying. You do the treatment plan. You choose your components. You do the mouth preparation in the patient's mouth. You make an impression with functional impression or anatomic impression. You seed the framework. Then you do your jaw relations. You do your trine. And finally, you get your RPD, which you insert. And this is your maintenance phase, which is very important. So this is a snapshot of the entire RPD procedure. But how am I going to design? What are my philosophies of design? The Venn diagram again. Very, very important. Three absolute sisters of designing are stress equalization, physiologic basing, and broad stress distribution. What is broad stress distribution? Rest, indirect retainers, broad coverage of denture base. Physiologic basing are functional impressions, which I already spoke to you. And stress equalization is the incorporation of stress directors or a precision or a semi-precision attachment, specifically in your class 1 and class 2 Kennedy situation. So three philosophies of design, very, very important. What are five elements of CPD design? Retention, stability, support, very, very important. It is there for CD, it's there for RPD, it's there for FPD. For all these, all the treatment modalities in prosthodontics, these three are always there. The remaining two, which are added in CPD, are the reciprocation and support. So these are two, which are very important for your CPD design. Remember, these are your five elements. And what are the components that are going to give you? Retention, obviously, direct and indirect retainer. Stability is going to be achieved by guide planes, bracing arms, reciprocation arms, lingual plates, rests, and denture bases. And your support is going to be given by your rests, your major connectors, and your denture bases. So that's what these components are going to give you, and how they're going to give you that retention, stability, support is what you need to learn. How are you going to design a cast partial denture with a given clinical scenario? Now, this is again something which you have to have a screenshot of this. Remember this. Let's first understand the steps, the algorithms, and then we are going to go in for CPD designing. In your answer sheet, you have to draw an accurate diagram of the upper and the lower arch or the cast, depicting your edentulous case and writing your final classification. The sequence of the choice of components and thereafter the CPD designs has to be followed, like first is the rest, which are in red, then your retention components, that is direct and indirect retainers, your connecting components, that is your major and minor connectors, your denture base and your choice of denture base materials, your selection of teeth and your occlusal scheme. And if you need any form of stress directors, then you're going to be mentioning those as well, that is precision and semi-precision attachments. Then you have to mention that what is your nature of support? Is it going to be tooth-supported, tissue-supported, or tooth-tissue-supported? Now, primarily, tooth-supported is a class 3 situation. A tissue-supported is a class 1 or a class 2 edentulous situation. A tooth-tissue is something which you don't have an extensive edentulous span. Mention your philosophy of design. As I told you, the three philosophies of design have to be mentioned. If you have a functional impression that needs to be done, point number 5, mention that you have to do a functional impression, and then draw your diagram with a completed CPD design. I'm going to show you how your diagrams look like, a schematic representation, in your following slides. So this is what, click a screenshot. This is how you're supposed to follow if you have to design a cast partial denture, or you've been asked in your Viva, how are you going to design? This is the sequence that you're going to follow. Now let's look at the first scenario. Look at this clinical picture on the top. It looks a typical maxillary Kennedy's class 1 situation. And if you see the design here down, then you can see it's a complete palatal plate, which is going to be my major connector. Then my lateral incisors have aesthetic class because obviously it's a lateral incisor. And clinical picture here. It's a class 3 modification 2. You have a pyre abutment in the center here on the premolar on this side. So this is your pyre abutment. Okay, this is your class 3 modification 2 areas. So now you can have in this region, you can have a circumferential clasp, as I told you. Here you can have your I-bar approaching clasp or your aesthetic clasp. Your pyre abutment, you're just going to have two rests. You're not going to be having any clasps on your pyre abutment. Again, a circumferential clasp here and an I-bar or an aesthetic clasp here. So this is how you're planning. Anteroposterior palatal bar is going to be your major connector. As I told you, that anteroposterior palatal bar are the favorite kind of tooth tissue supported kind of major connector. So that's your design down on the right. And that's what how you design a typical situation of a class 3 modification 2. As you can see, I've already explained to you, that's your schematic diagram down on the right. You go to the next one. It's a class 4 situation. As I told you, class 4 has no modifications because that's your anterior edentulous pain, which is crossing the midline. A class 4 situation, it's a closed horseshoe is a major connector, which is your major connector of choice. Now, as you see here, if you can see particularly, this is going to be my major connector. That is going to be my closed horseshoe major connector. I have my abutments here and here. So when I have this canine, I want to use, for the canine, I would use an aesthetic clasp or an I-bar approaching clasp. And for the premolar, I can use a circumferential clasp or an I-bar depending on the aesthetic zone. So that's what is my choice of component. And that's how I'm going to be planning. Obviously, in the region where I have my edentulous span, my minor connector is going to be a meshwork. Remember, in my class 1 and class 2 situation also, give a minor connector which has the need for relining, you can give a ladder or a meshwork kind of a design, never a metal on the edentulous spans. So that's how I design my class 4 situation. Then I go to the class 2 modification. This is a mandibular arch. As I said, if you have enough depth of lingual sulcus, you can use a lingo bar. And then this is a class 2 situation which will require or necessitate the use of an indirect retainer. This is my fulcrum line, right angle. So I have a canine rest, which is going to act as my indirect retainer, my lingual bar. This is going to be my RPI clasp. So this is my tooth for my RPI. And maybe I can use a circumferential clasp and again, a I-bar clasp. So this is again the design. As I said, your RPI is your choice of component when you have a class 2 or a class 1, Kennedy's class 1 situation. So that's something very, very important again that you all must remember. So as I said that, in this situation, an RPI clasp here on my abutment tooth, which is my distal abutment tooth, an indirect retainer, which is right angled, that is a cingulum rest or a canine rest on my canine, which is at right angle to my fulcrum line, and my two other direct retainers, which can be an I-bar approaching clasp and a occlusally approaching clasp. So this is my tripodal kind of design, which I'm using for my direct retainers, and lingo bar is my major connector. Don't forget, minor connectors are linking all the components together. Okay, so this is a typical class 2 modification 2 situation design. Modification areas also act as indirect retainers, you must remember. Next, we go to a class 2 modification 1 design. I have shown the difference because if you do not have depth of lingual sulcus, you use a lingual plate. Lingual plate, again, this is an extensive edentulous span, so you have to use a lingual plate, which is covering the entire area. I want to use, this is one sole isolated molar. I will use a ring clasp for the isolated mandibular molar of mine because it acts bracing. It's a bracing component. Then I have my premolar here. I have my canine, both my premolars here. So I use an RPI here. I use an RPI here. I can use a combination clasp as well. And my indirect retainer is obviously going to be my lingo plate because my lingo plate is going to be covering all the cingulum of my anterior teeth. So that's how I design my extensive class 2 modification to modification 1 situation here. So to repeat again, a lingo plate is my major connector as well as acting as my indirect retainer. My RPI clasp on my premolars I can use. I can use a combination clasp if there's a soft tissue undercut as my direct retainer. And an isolated molar which I have here, I can use my ring clasp. So that's your choice of design in a particular class 2 modification 1 situation. As I said, I mentioned to you, class 1 and class 2 Kennedy situation requires stress breakers. The right terminology is not stress breakers. They don't break the stress. They redirect the stress. Hence, you must know them as stress equalizers or stress directors. What is the definition? GPT-9 definition is they redirect the forces to the load-bearing structures. And how do they look like? They can be intracoronal, extracoronal, or they can be resilient or non-resilient. So basically, precision attachments and semi-precision attachments are the ones which are particularly used as stress directors in class 1 and class 2 situations. What do? They allow some form of movement. Because if you have a very, very rigid connection again, then it is going to be detrimental to your abutment tooth. So it's kind of the redirecting the forces and allowing some form of micro movement between the rigid component and the non-rigid components. And some amount of movement is allowed so that it does not cause any undue stresses on the underlying ridge or on the abutment tooth. Recent advances. We are leaps and bounds advancing in the science of dental materials. We must be abreast of all the recent advances that are happening, not just in prosthodontics, but all the fields of dentistry. And in the science of dental materials, what do we use for the fabrication of your cast partial dentures is cobalt chromium, very commonly used, veroniums, titanium is very light in weight, hence it's used, zirconia is used, DMLS is the technology, very, very important for you to know. That you must know DMLS, that is direct metal laser sintering, is the DMLS technology where powder is completely sintered, cobalt chromium powder is sintered, and you get the entire framework. You don't need to use the casting procedures, which are so conventional and which are so precision, demanding precision, and have a lot of inherent errors. And CAD-CAM, obviously, CAD-CAM and the role of CAD and digitalization has revolutionized dentistry. So CAD is something which is absolutely a software generated. Everything is planned on the computer and the software, and you can mill or you can directly have a fabrication of a cast partial denture. These are the latest advances. You must know about it because we are in the era where we are. Technology is probably taking us in leaps and bounds. Few of the mind teasers as we are almost coming to the end of my session, wherein if you try and look at these two situations, just look at the left-hand side clinical situation wherein it's a distal extension case, but it is crossing the midline as well. So it doesn't fall typically into a class 2 situation, neither does it fall into a Kennedy's class 4 situation. Look at this situation, just a single central incisor missing. It doesn't cross the midline, it's not a distal extension, it is not a class 3 situation. Well, these are mind teasers because it allows our mind to think again. There are limitations of Kennedy's classification as well. And these are the ones which actually keep us thinking that how am I going to classify these situations? Well, just for your knowledge, this not to confuse you, but our mind has to keep thinking so that we learn and we grow more. As I've always emphasized in this last 1 hour, that our answers